staan naar hem! Bangado!
It's time to celebrate that we finally hit 5k with a 5k subscriber special! Well, better late than never, right? I know it's been very late since I promised to do this video and when we hit 5k, but to answer your question and to basically give myself an excuse of why this video is very late, a lot of stuff happened. First off, Bushra decided to bombard us with a lot of information because they wanted to release 4 sets in 2 months, so I had to do a lot of videos. And with the time when I thought, you know what, I now have time to do this video, Nature thought, you know what, you're now sick. You're sick for 3 to 4 weeks, and with that, it basically was snowballing from that point onward to disaster, as I was falling behind with a lot of content and I had no time to doing this video. Also, work came was suddenly bugging me with other kinds of responsibilities, and as you might see in the channel, we're trying to pick up with a lot of content right now, as we're in the middle of doing the set reviews and deck profiles for Logical Destruction, Light of Salvation, Logical Destruction, and right after that we need to jump right into the Heroic Evolution set before My Glorious Justice is completely revealed, as we then need to jump into that set, and I also need to do some premium collection stuff as well. So yeah, premium content also coming to the channel, but there is a lot to do, and I'm now taking a breather. And we're gonna have a relaxing video, and we're finally gonna do the 5k subscriber special before we're hitting 6k. But without further ado, let's jump right into these questions, because you guys have been waiting long enough on your answers. So we're gonna do that right about now. What type of books do you read? Examples, novel, manga, light novel? So right off the bat, we're hitting with some hard-hitting questions. I'm not really that of a reader. I rarely, very rarely read some books. But when I do, my preferences go to stories that are in the fantasy adventure category, or more of a post-apocalyptic kind of setting, as well as dystopian futures. But in terms of light novels and manga, so the more the anime route, it's the same story there. I haven't read any manga or light novel as of today. That is, however, changing. I managed to collect quite a big stash of first volumes of all kinds of different stories, and I'm very intrigued to a couple of series like Goblin Slayer, Rising of the Shield Hero, Log Horizon, as well as Konosuba, to see how the story progresses. So I'm probably gonna collect multiple copies of different volumes so I can see where the story is going outside of the anime. What keeps you playing Vanguard? Well, the main only thing that keeps you playing or doing anything that for a long period of time, it's fun. It's basically fun. Also, now that I'm doing a channel, I'm somewhat forced to keep doing it to keep the channel going. But mainly, I'm still enjoying it because it's a really fun game. What hobbies did you have before becoming Card Fighter, and do you still enjoy those hobbies today? Well, main hobby of most people that are playing card games, that is basically video games. Although I'm not very active currently, I do have a Switch and I do play me some Zelda and Super Smash and all those kinds of jazz. But in terms of video gaming, I don't do that as much as I used to do in the past. But another big hobby that I had before I was card fighting was playing the guitar. I used to play about 7 years before I did card fighting. I played the guitar, so about 10 years ago I started picking up. In the last past year, when I actually been doing this channel a lot more actively, I haven't really touched my guitar in that time, so it's been quite a while that I last played the guitar. But I do enjoy it a lot, and I'm planning to pick it up once again when I have a little bit more time ahead. But over the times, I've collected quite a lot of guitars, and I also played in some fair amount of different bands, or at least cover bands at the time. But sadly, it's not really that active at the moment. Which card has caused you to say why it exists? So the card in question for me personally, it has to be Dragon Deity of Destruction, Geese. As Geese is, in my opinion, a terrible design card. And we're not talking about competitive-wise, because competitive-wise it doesn't really do that much. But I'm just talking about a playability perspective, as well as a trying to make a fun or playable game. It doesn't make any sense, as you're just doing nothing. And that's also for the player that's playing, as well as the player that's fighting against it, as the card really invites a stall type of game plan, as you don't want to give him damage, you immediately want to hit him for damage, but also your deck doesn't really do that much and you're relying on triggers, so you're basically waiting until the triggers happen, then you do something, then you wait until the skill resolves, and then you win or you lose. And you don't do anything besides that. The game isn't really fun to or enjoyable at the time when that card is the main focus by either one of the players. And I've experienced it myself, playing against it, playing with it. A lot of friends of mine did the same. And I don't know a lot of people that can say, I really enjoy playing against Geese, or I really enjoy playing with Geese. It's just not a fun card. And that's the big card that I just ask, why? Why did they design the card the way that it is? They could have gone so many different routes as a final boss monster of their main series, but they instead went with this generic, degenerate thing. What VRs do you hope to see on the cover of AO4 Wave 3? Well, as seen as this video is a little bit late and we now already know the cover of the card, we know that it's Mordred Phantom for Shadow Paladin, but let's talk about it as if I didn't know that. I can already assume, and anybody could assume, that it's probably going to be a Shadow Paladin card, but let's go a different route, as I'm not really fond of Shadow Paladin that much. I'm more of a Dark Regulars and Pale Moon kind of player, and if it was a Pale Moon card, I would love to see Lucciar on the box, as I really hope that Lucciar is going to get a comeback in the V-Series. As for Dark Regulars, I would hope for Steel Vampyr, as that's my number one favorite card for Dark Regulars, as Steel Vampyr is a fun and trolley card that I really like back in GR when I put it into my Bladewing deck and surprised a lot of players at the time, and I could ruffle stomp and curb stomp them with a 56 crit Vanguard attack, triple drive, where they're sitting at a 4k Vanguard and they couldn't G-guard PG or whatsoever. Yeah, good memories. What is or are the most hated cards in Vanguard in terms of bad memories? For bad memories and the most hated cards, it has to be the Zangeki Rinnick combo, as well as the Billful Repressor Balaam combo from the latest, second to last support set for the Jira. As those two decks were really, really annoying to deal with. And the reason why I hated them as much is that both decks do the same thing. They punish your opponent or the player that, or me basically, if I'm facing against them. They're punishing me for playing the game. For playing cards, doing stuff, I'm getting punished because those things are just saying, well, yeah, because you do this, you're now gonna get killed because of all these things. And I don't like that. I don't like cards that punish me for playing the game or limit me in such a significant amount that it's not even an option to play the game. A good example of this is Lockex as well. It's not fun to play those things if you're limited. And once again, I'm talking about fun aspect, not meta or competitive play, as in competitive play, you're just gonna play top tier decks, or you're just gonna play to win, because that's competitive play. And you're talking about enjoying the game, when I just want to play for fun. Then I hate those cards with a passion. What do you honestly think of the upcoming Blaster support? Viable or hot garbage? Well, you've probably already seen my set review of the Blaster card or the Royal Paladin support card for this set. And to be honest, I'm somewhere in between. I don't think it's nowhere near competitive, mettable, reliable, or as strong as Elfred. But it's also, in my opinion, not completely hot garbage, as the deck can still win some games and they have a lot of potential. The only main issue with the deck is that, one, thanks to the updated ruling, or basically the correct ruling for Arcsaver Dragon, that card is no longer actionable viable. But also the main issue is that we miss a certain amount of blaster cards. We need more blaster cards. And as of date, we do not have those, and it makes the deck more gimmicky. It's more on the gimmick side. But the moment that we get more blaster cards, like in premium, then suddenly this deck can spike all the way to competitive viable. So don't underestimate it right now. You might want to pick up your cards as soon as they are released, as they are cheap right now and they might become very expensive when we get that one or two extra blaster cards. What do you think the gauge decks need to work to be viable? I think Chachikaze is already in a very good spot right now, as it's a very highly aggressive deck, but at the same time can have some hand consistency, so they can dump their hand, do their stuff, and then refill their hand in the same breath. And that makes them really strong. The only downside to the fact of the gauge system is that it comes with two major downsides. One, you're gonna go deck out, as you're gonna go through a lot. You're gauging a lot of cards from your deck, as well as drawing a lot of deck cards from your deck to refresh your hand. But at the same time, you're also gauging your cards blindly, so there's a lot of chance that you're going to gauge all your triggers, and that's not what you want to see. So what they can do to increase the consistency of the deck, as well as make it a little bit more viable, is maybe have some recursion with their gauges. Maybe when a unit is destroyed and the gauges are removed, maybe have a unit that says, states that when the gauges are removed from the game, or at least removed from the field so they go to the drop zone, put them back to the deck instead. So your deck, so the trigger units will be put back into the deck, or at least you're not going to as fast to deck out as you used to. And another thing that they can maybe do is instead blindly gauging from the top of their deck, maybe let them gauge from the drop zone instead, or maybe from their hand. It's not that new to see, as seen as Genesis can gauge from the soul, so they have somewhat control over what they're gonna gauge and what not. Maybe do that as well for Tachikaze. That can maybe make the deck a little bit more consistent. What are your top 3 least favorite clans, decks in GR, Fiora, and overall? I'm gonna answer this question just in general, just 3 decks that I really dislike. And once again, we're not talking about competitive, we're just talking about casual. The top 3 decks are gonna be any Link Joker deck that focuses around blocking, the Rinna Dominate deck, as well as the Baleful Balaam Repressor cannot guard, you cannot guard Dark Irregulars deck. Those 3 decks all are not fun to play, in my opinion. They are not fun to play as well as play against, as they just limit your opponent in doing anything, or they limit me in doing anything, and I cannot just play the game. I'm getting punished for playing the game, and I just want to freaking play the game. That's why I'm playing the game. So stop making me punished for playing the game. So that's are probably my least favorite decks in Vanguard. But once again, I'm just talking about casual play. When you're playing competitive, you're just playing competitive. You're going to be faced against these decks, and you need to accept that as people are trying to win and they're trying to play the best decks in the format. Otherwise, you're not playing competitively. What do you think of Article 13? It's crap. What's the story behind Gun Basil Dragon? So the question refers to this thing, basically the big cardboard board card that you've seen in most videos behind me like this in all every video. And yeah, the story behind this is this is the official card that was revealed during the BCS in the Netherlands, in Eindhoven, and the shop owner that was hosting the tournament got that card from Bushra. They basically said, here you go, this is for you, present for us, you can use it in the store, do whatever you want. I am on good terms with the shop owner, and he came to me, yo, I know that you have a channel, I know you like Gear Chronicle and all this stuff, do you want it so you can put it in your videos as a background of what? And I was like, hell yes, give it to me. I would want that, yes. So, and with that, I got the card, and then it was into the video, and the rest is history. Since Time Leap and Bloom are your most favorite decks in G, and that the premium collection is going to support the keyword mechanics, so can we expect 2 premium deck profiles from you, one for Time Leap and another for Bloom? The answer is yes. I'm currently working on a Time Leap build as we speak right now. I've been pitching this idea with a lot of other Gear Chronicle players, most notably W Slasher, and I'm almost done with the build that I've been concocting in my head. Not 100% satisfied just yet, so I need a little bit more time, but when that's done, you can expect a video on that deck profile. As same as with Bloom, I'm gonna start building on that deck after I'm done with Time Leap. It's gonna be a little bit different than you usually see, as the typical list is mostly focused around the standard cards for Neo Nectar, but I'm not really fond of those engine, as that's a very one-dimensional and very dull game plan. I'm gonna probably incorporate the Arsha and Bloom cards, as that's a lot more fun in my opinion and can have some wacky interactions, and that's all what I'm about. What's your favorite trigger and why? I've been thinking about this for quite some time, and there is basically only one answer that I can give, and that's the fact that, for my personal opinion, it's the heal trigger. And the reason why it's my most favorite is because of the heal trigger, I started to be interested in Vanguard, and it's also the reason why I play Vanguard. As in most other card games like Magic or Yu-Gi-Oh, you can build a certain field, and at some point in the game, you look at the board, and you can see the state of the game, and say, the game is now and it's now over. When I swing with my blue S-White Dragon, it has 3,000 attack power, you have 2,000 attack power, and when I swing with it, you're going to minus 1,000 and I'm gonna win the game. However, in Vanguard, that's not the case, as you have no way of knowing with 100% certainty that when you swing with that card, when you deal the damage, that you know you're gonna win, as heal triggers are a thing, and with that potential heal trigger, he can survive that turn and then swing back at you and probably or potentially win the game. And that uncertainty of not knowing 100% certain of that you're gonna win or lose the game has made me interested in the game of Carta Vanguard in it as a whole. And it's only made possible thanks to heal triggers. So the only thing that I can say that my favorite triggers are, in fact, heal triggers, thanks to the fact that they incorporate this uncertainty and this tense moment that's consistently going through the game from the moment you start up the game and the moment the game is finally over. There are rare occasions where triggers, or at least heal triggers, will not factor anymore, or that you know for certain, no matter what, I'm gonna win anyway. Those scenarios do come up, but not always. And that makes this game, in my opinion, so much more interesting than most other card games. What is or are the most beautiful cards with bad abilities? In the new series, I'm gonna say most Grade 1 Perfect Guard. Good example is the Gear Chronicle PG. The Grade 1 PG has a much better art, in my opinion, than this Draw PG, as I would have loved to swap those one around and just play with the Grade 1 if it's a Draw PG, as I like those vibrant colors way more than the dark, gritty one from the Draw PG. I mean, we're Gear Chronicle, we're not freaking Shadow Paladin. Give me those vibrant colors that you see on steampunk cards. But the main culprit of this thing in terms of Gear Chronicle, and it's my personal opinion because I missed the timing for a reason, main culprit for this one was the first GR of the first character booster for Gear Chronicle, and that is none other than Crossover Dragon. That card's art is beautiful. It's so amazing, that card art, especially the SGR. It looks incredible. But the skill is so terrible. It's so stupid. It doesn't work in any shape or form. We couldn't use it at the time, and we still can't use it now. So I really hate that the one of the most beautiful card arts is on such a terrible skill. So yeah, what advice do you have for marketing a channel? Before I'm answering this question, you should note I am no marketing expert or a genius whatsoever. When we look at the grand scheme of things, I am a very, very small channel in the big picture of YouTube, where people have millions, hundreds, thousands of views each minute or whatever. I'm just a very small channel in that sense, although in our community where things are a little bit, quite a big amount smaller, I'm not really that small of a channel in sense of what, in comparison with the rest. So that's where this is coming into picture. But once again, I am no marketing genius. From my personal opinion, there are two major things you want to focus on. One is making a unique type of content that's very unique to your channel. So give viewers a reason to watch your video. Especially nowadays, where there are a lot of different channels that do a lot of the same content, you want to give your viewers a reason why they watch you instead of another person, or at least watch you after they already watch 20 type of videos that are very similar to yours. A good example of this is Chris from Different Fight. In the past, he did a lot of comedy sketches that were very unique at the time, and now he's doing a lot of videos where he uses his knowledge of playing the game for almost since the beginning. A good example in the video terms is his previous video where he talked about the original ban list. That's the type of content that only he can make, or at least make unique to him in the style that with his expertise. Now for the actual marketing aspects, or point two, you just want to put out your videos as much as possible. Go to different Facebook groups. Go to all kinds of threads on Twitter or on Reddit or all those kinds of stuff. And also interact with your audience when somebody's responding on your videos with the comment section, or somebody's private messaging you through Facebook or Twitter. Try to interact with your audience and make an established community with your own channel as the main focus. Now, for the final question, and a big question that has been looming on this channel ever since the channel got some growth, and that is, what happened to the Stride table? So basically, ever since I did the first video, when Different Fight made a video about the Stride table, and I did some videos regarding the progress of the development, ever since I didn't do anything and didn't touch about the subject anymore, I keep getting questions on comments about how's the project, what's the status, how's it going, any progress, what's this, what's that, what's... Today, I'm gonna answer those questions once and for all, so you guys know what's up and what's potentially happening in the future and all those kinds of jazz. For those who don't know, I made a project that's called the Stride Table, and it is basically a digital fighting table that we've seen in the anime that is just putting out animations on the screen and can generate, can show power level and show increases of power, and you can, all those statistics will be keeping track while you're playing the game, and all those kinds of neat interactions, as well as some battlefield animations and all those kinds of awesome things. The project is on hold for an indefinite time. I don't know for how long and what I'm gonna do in the near future or far future, depending on the project. And there are two reasons for that. First one, you can probably already guess, the reboot. Thanks to the reboot, a lot of things change depending on the core mechanic of the game. Gift markers are pretty damn different if I want to incorporate that in the software. But the biggest issue and the biggest annoyance is axel circles. The fact that they're gonna be more random rearguard circles that I need to work with, that popping out of nowhere, and there is no limit to them, so my screen is limited to a certain size, and I cannot support that many circles at a certain point. So that made an issue that I still need to solve. But another, and I think the biggest issue why I put it on hold, because I already put it on hold right before the reboot actually took off, that's the fact that there is currently no way possible for me to ever make the table marketing-wise accessible. I cannot make a full viable product, as it's still a personal hobby product. It's basically, I put some appliance, put them together, put some software on a computer chip, and put it out there on a wooden frame, and that's it. I cannot sell that. You cannot sell that whatsoever. It's not like an Xbox or something. This is really a hacked-in system with multiple devices put together. First off, I need to make a way to make that sellable. But then there is another big issue, and that's transport. I cannot transport this stuff to maybe somebody in America or something. That is impossible for me, as there is a limit, there's a size limit and a weight limit, and that thing is exceeding both those limits by far. So if I ever want to do something with that project, I need to have a big investor, a big company that says, you know what, I like that, we're gonna buy that, or we're gonna invest that so we can manufacture that to a professional standpoint and do something. Because of those limitations, I could no longer stay, I'm gonna work on it and make it a community project. And that's not possible. I cannot bring this table to you guys. That's impossible for me, as I do not have the funds for that. So that's why I put it on hold. The only thing that I can do is I can still develop the table, work on it, but then you can only see it on the videos, as there can only be, I can only make one of it, as I cannot manufacture multiple copies and then selling them out or shipping them out. That's not possible for me. There's no way I have that capital or that business size. So that's the main reason why it's currently on hold. But there's also a third reason, and that's basically time constraint. As there's a lot of time going into this channel, as well as my work outside of channel, because I need to have an income, there's not really that much time left to do other stuff. And I'm currently also working on some other projects that I'm very excited for that will be live in a couple of weeks, that take basically the rest spare time that I have free. And besides that, I've also other projects in line that I really want to work on that can really benefit you guys, as it can push out to you. And that's why those projects are a little bit higher up my to-do list, as not only do I benefit from it, but also you will benefit from them, as you can enjoy those projects. So I feel a little bit guilty to work on this thing and say, yo guys, support me in doing this, but only I can benefit from them. I think that that isn't fair, unless you guys are saying, well, I don't mind to just seeing it on the video because it's really awesome, and maybe if we're lucky, somebody in the high ups in the company sees it and then says, all right, I'm interested in that, and maybe that. But I cannot guarantee that. The only thing I can guarantee is that, yes, I can work on it and I can make videos about it, but that's about it for now. And I don't know if that's fair enough. So my main focus is on projects that not only me, but also you guys can enjoy, as that is currently my main focus as of doing this channel as a main project. But I'm very curious what your opinion is concerning the whole Tri-Table project, as well as that I'm putting on hold and I'm focusing more on other projects, or at least more other video projects. So let me know in this poll right here what your opinion is, and maybe I can do something with that information, or at least see some insight of what you guys actually want, as I might change some plans or maybe know that I'm on the good track and keep going and focusing on the things that I'm currently doing. But that's basically all the questions that you guys asked me about a couple of months ago now. Maybe it was one, two, I don't even know. But I finally answered those questions and I think we're just in time for, well, we're still at 5K. As I believe we're now at, what, 5,900 and probably... Well, 1 week from now, we're hitting the 6K. So, yeah, and once again, I want to thank you guys for the amazing support. That the growth that we had is insane. And the support that I get from you guys, the comments, interactions, reactions on every single video is really amazing. I'm very happy and I'm very honored to the guy that you guys are enjoying my content. And I'm love to make even more for you guys. So I hope I can get to see you in the comment sections down below in this video or at least in some future videos, as I love making videos for you guys as well as playing Vanguard and enjoying the community as we are right now. But that said, this video is going on for way too long. I'm gonna end it up right now. But before that, I want to thank my Patreon supporters over at Patreon for making this channel possible. If you do want to support me on Patreon, then head on over to patreon.com/VanguardInsider and become a patron today. But that's all for me today. I'm Mr. Timeleap and I see you guys in the next one.